Well, hello everyone and welcome to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it. The psalmist reminds us of the gift of each new day, filled with the promise of God's presence and the hope of new beginnings. I greet you in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Karen, Rachel, Emma, Nathan and I welcome you to our home once again and to this special time of worship, praise, prayer and reflection. Living as we are in what has been termed a post-truth society or a post-truth era, in which many people appeal less to facts and more to emotion and personal opinion in framing their worldview and their reality, it is vital to hold on to that which has not changed since the dawn of time, or perhaps rather I should say, to hold on to the one who has not changed since the dawn of time, our Lord God, in whom truth and grace is birthed. What we celebrate and worship every week is not an untested opinion, nor is it an emotional manipulation. Rather, it is the revealed truth of Jesus Christ and the work of His Holy Spirit in the lives of millions upon millions of people who bear testimony to having a living relationship with a loving, personal, and gracious Creator. And so, as we navigate these troubled times, we turn in trust and faith to God, holding on to the One who has been, who is, and who will be forevermore. Karen is going to lead us in our call to worship.
Today's call to worship comes to us from Psalm 145. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all He has made. All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you. They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all people may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations.
Friends, everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Our God is mighty to save.
Forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior.
Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, you have called us to be your people, a mighty nation, a holy priesthood, the body of Christ, his hands and feet and voice in the world. As your people, we gather together in our homes, along with millions all over the world, in worship and prayer. We join in the great wave of praise, united by your Holy Spirit. Lord, you made our minds, so help us to know you. You made our hearts, so help us to love you. You made our voices, so help us to sing your praise, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Forgive us for those moments this week when we have slipped into old sinful habits, when we have said and done things that have hurt others and ourselves. We acknowledge that our sin pains your heart too, and we ask you to forgive us. Lord, it is with grateful thanks that we receive your mercy as a forgiven people. May we move forward in the power of your Spirit to live as Jesus would have us live. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen. Thanks so much, Emma. Our offertory reading and prayer today will be led by Fossey Redlinges.
Our reading comes from Matthew 6, verse 19 to 24. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. Then the light within you is darkness. How great that darkness! No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money.
Friends, the day will come again when we will meet together as MidChurch for Sunday worship. And as part of our time together, we will receive your tithes and offerings during worship. But until then, you are encouraged to give by EFTs or direct deposits into the church bank account. Our giving is an act of worship, a thanksgiving to God, and an investment in the life and work of his kingdom and towards the proclamation of his gospel. MidChurch's bank details are on our website, www.midchurch.co.za. You can also make use of our QR code, using the app of your choice, of course, to bring your tithes and your offerings. I want to mention our food parcel project this week, because just when we think that the project may well have run its course and that we will need to consider what our next step will be, more donations are received and another week of ordering goods and packing parcels becomes possible. As I shared with you on Wednesday on the MidChurch WhatsApp groups, the team was able to pack another 60 parcels for distribution this week. And then on Friday, I heard that they'll be able to do the same this coming week and the week after that. There is no time here to share all the stories with you of families and individuals who have gratefully received the food. Suffice it to say that lives are being blessed in the name of Jesus, and I thank God for that. Also, don't forget to send your prayer requests by email to prayer@midchurch.co.za.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are God, and there is none like you. By you all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth. You warn us not to store up treasures here on earth, where it will be destroyed and stolen. You love us with an eternal love, and we give you our offerings as an expression of our love for you. And by doing so, we store up treasure in your kingdom. We pray our gifts would be used to extend your kingdom in our land. May you, the God of all love and grace, make us holy, strong, and filled with peace. To you be glory and honor forever and ever. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, and thank you, Fossey. So today is Father's Day in South Africa. As much as we are aware that there are many men in our country and indeed the world who don't take their responsibility as fathers seriously, there are just too many children being raised without the positive presence of their fathers. At the same time, there are also many fathers and father figures who are doing their best for their children. And don't forget, dads, that it is never too late to love your children. So here is a lovely clip from the Skit Guys to celebrate our dads, those present and past.
No matter how old we are, we always remember what our dads say and do.
My dad is more like Jesus than your dad.
Nuh-uh. My dad doesn't let anybody eat any food until we pray for it.
My dad prays for 1 minute every day.
You know what? Our church has pancakes.
This is what my sister Mom used for their blush.
My dad says that mean kids never know what they're talking about. Because their parents don't know what they're talking about either.
My dad says to punch meanies in the face.
Then my mom says, don't ever do that.
And my dad goes to time out.
My dad's beard is itchy whenever he kisses me.
My dad takes me to church so we could learn to be just like Jesus.
My daddy prays for me. Then he makes me stop talking and go to bed. Then I get a flashlight and read my comic book.
That's a sin. He's sinning.
No, I'm not.
Sinner.
No, I'm not.
R2. R2.
R2.
R2.
My dad said that if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say it.
My dad never stays mad at me.
My dad taught me to forgive, because Jesus forgives us every time we ask.
I want a mohawk.
I wish I had hair.
It's okay, your hair will probably grow back.
Thanks for being our dads for all our lives.
Happy Father's Day, guys. Right, it's time for the message for today, so let's pray together. Lord God, as we come to your word to us today, we affirm that you have inspired all scripture, which has been written to reveal your word to us. Teach us now, we pray, as your scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed. Shine your light into our hearts, that we may know your truth and be moved to act in accordance with your good will and your guidance. Amen. Now, most of you won't know what this is, even though it plays a vital role in the life and work of our congregation. This is the Manual of Faith and Order of the Uniting Presbyterian Church in Southern Africa. This is our rule book, our policies, our polity as a church. And it covers a myriad of different subjects. Of course, there's a chapter on the church, on the faith of the church, on baptism, on Holy Communion, on marriage, divorce and remarriage. There's a chapter, of course, on the congregation, the session, the congregation's finances, immovable property, the presbytery, the synod, the general assembly, commissions and committees, rules of procedures in all the councils, administrative reviews and dissenters and complaints. There's a chapter on ministry, on admission to the ministry. Then there's chapter 18, and everyone knows about chapter 18. It's the chapter on discipline. Then there's the one on rules, and they're coming into effect. And then there's just a whole list of appendices. Now, over the years, some in the denomination have had difficulty with what is termed the manual, saying that there are too many rules, that it's legalistic, that it stifles the work of the Spirit in the church. But the truth is that often those who speak poorly about the manual are usually those who have been found to be on the wrong side of it. Yes, it is true that some in the church have used the rules in the manual to posture, and to pontificate and to hurt others. But that is not what it is intended for. You will notice that this manual comes with a ring binder. It's got these things for putting pages in and for taking them out whenever necessary. Because sometimes the rules and the regulations are amended or they are removed as the church responds to different circumstances. In fact, I can show you some rules that have had to be added over the years because of the bad behavior of some ministers or elders. And I know this because I've been part of some of them. I mean, of the writing of the new rules, not being the cause of having to have new rules. The reality is that sometimes people do bad things, or they act in a way to take advantage of a situation or to take advantage of others. And then, realizing that there is a loophole or a gap in the church laws, we plug it with a new rule. But the consequence is that some perceive the manual to be nothing more than a legalistic document designed to make life difficult for ministry. But that is not the intention. Rules, laws, all laws are created with the intention of preventing actions that will hurt others. Of course, there are also laws, as we have seen in the history of our own country, that were designed to protect and favor some in our society to the detriment of others. But if you have a good constitution like we do, the laws are meant to protect people and to stop behavior that is harmful to others and to society at large. This is exactly why God gave us the Ten Commandments. If you remember back to our teaching series last year on the Ten Commandments, it was pointed out that the purpose of the commandments was to reveal God's character to us, that He is a God of order and justice and goodness, and also to provide us with the boundaries within which community life could flourish. So in other words, the Ten Commandments, the thou shalt nots, are intended to stop behavior that is hurtful towards ourselves and towards others, and so provide us with the foundations upon which a society can be built in which we can experience a blessed life. So, mostly, laws are created to point out behaviors or actions that, if left unchecked, will lead to injustice and unfairness and the breaking of social order and community life. The laws are intended for our good. And as I said, I'm thankful to live in a country with one of the finest constitutions in the world, which, by the way, is based on Judeo-Christian values and teachings, and is designed to create the framework for a society that should be for the benefit and the blessing of all of its citizens. Should be. Do people still behave badly and break the laws and try and find loopholes and take advantage for selfish gain? Yes, but that is why the laws are there, so that people can be held accountable and we can point out behavior that is destructive. Of course, if everyone behaved well and treated others with respect, kindness, love, and compassion, there would be no need for any laws. Laws should be given to manage people's actions and behaviors so as to create a society that is fair and in which people can flourish. Last week, we came to the end of our series of Living a Saved Life when we looked at the final fruit of the Holy Spirit, self-control, which I am pleased to hear from all the feedback I've received after the sermon that none of you seem to have a problem with. Not. In Galatians 5, 22 and 23, Paul points out to us that when God's Spirit lives in us, He begins, if we allow Him, to change us, to be more and more like Jesus. And when that happens, our lives begin to produce evidence or proof of the change that He is busy making, which we know as the list of the nine fruit of the Holy Spirit. Now, we have read these two verses several times over the past months, and I wonder if many of you have taken note of how verse 23 ends. Paul tacks on the end of the list of the fruit a statement that is deeply significant and will help you make sense of why I've been going on about laws. So let's read it again. Galatians 5, 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Against such things there is no law. I mean, can you imagine a government passing a law that stated something like, anyone caught acting kindly towards another will be arrested, and if convicted, face a fine or imprisonment. I mean, it's ludicrous. No one would ever make a law like that. Thou shalt not be gentle. Thou shalt not be good. Thou shalt not be patient. Thou shalt not be joyful. The reason that there is no law against these things is because these things bring life and blessing and fullness. Who would want to make a law against living fully? In John 10, verse 10, Jesus tells us that he came to bring us life in all of its fullness. God's business is life and blessing and joy and hope and kindness and goodness and love. And that is what God's Spirit is trying to generate in you and in me when we place our faith in Jesus. There cannot be a law against the fruit of the Holy Spirit, because those things do not breed pain and destruction and hurt. So when God says in Jeremiah 31, verse 33, the following, this is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. When God spoke this through Jeremiah 600 years before Jesus, he was talking about a time when his Holy Spirit would live in his people and would move them to live in a way so that written laws would not be necessary. If everyone lived with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, if everyone lived that way, there would be no need for the laws of our land, or dare I say, even for the laws of our church. God's Spirit only brings things that are good, that result in blessing. There cannot be a law against the work of God's Spirit because it is good. Of course, we do not always get this right. We frustrate the work of God's Spirit in us. We make mistakes. We resist the Holy Spirit. We act selfishly, arrogantly, unkindly. However, because of the grace and the mercy of God, we are forgiven and we are able to start over again. We are able to invite the Spirit to continue with his transforming work in our lives, even after we have messed up. And I believe in the power of God to change a person so that his fruit is evidenced in a transformed heart and mind. I believe it completely. And that is why I love doing this teaching and preaching and telling others about Jesus and his saving power, because I know that he can change us and that the fruit of his Spirit can be present in our lives, even in the life of the most wretched amongst us, if we open our hearts to Jesus and his Spirit. I've shared with you before how I personally have experienced the work of God's Spirit in changing my life. I grew up going to worship every Sunday because both my parents were involved in ministry and leadership, and so I had to go along with them, and my kids are busy nodding knowingly. I learned from an early age about Jesus' love for me, and I can remember as a young boy inviting Jesus to live in my heart and my life, and doing so over and over again, just in case he left unnoticed. But in my teen years, I got involved with the wrong crowd in my neighborhood. I went off the tracks, as they say, with drinking and much else from the age of 15. At school, I had a group of friends who were foul-mouthed, as I was, and who would spend break times objectifying all the girls and speaking quite poorly about people. But then in my late teens, I went forward for prayer in a worship service, and I rededicated my life to Jesus, and I asked him to be my Lord and my Savior. Now, there was no lightning bolts or heavenly choirs, but the very next day, I noticed the change. When I went to go and sit with my friends at break time, and the conversation turned to the usual topics, I suddenly felt extremely uncomfortable. I didn't find their comments about others acceptable or humorous. And I also realized that I wasn't swearing anymore. So I stood up and I told them I didn't want to sit with them anymore. They asked me why, and I said that I didn't like the things they were saying about the girls, nor did I enjoy their swearing. They asked me what it God meant to me. And I said, rather matter of fact, well, yesterday I gave my life to Jesus. Well, the typical ridicule and taunts followed. Oh, Jules found Jesus, you know, all that. I wasn't concerned and I headed off. And I realized then that I had not planned to think differently or to speak differently that Monday. It simply happened. It was God's Spirit changing me. And I don't pretend for a second that I am perfect in any way, or that I have never sworn again since that day at high school, or said something hurtful to others or about others, or had one too many drinks. But I have absolutely no doubt that God has been changing me ever since. That little by little, lesson by lesson, He is trying, if I allow Him, to teach me, to make me into someone who can be used by Him, to bring love and joy and peace and kindness and gentleness into the world. And not because of anything of my doing, but because of His Spirit that is at work in me. And against such things, there is no law. Because God's work is never sanctioned, is never ruled out of order, because His work brings life and blessing. Friends, I invite you, I encourage you, I exhort you to welcome God's Holy Spirit into your life. Ask for Him to fill you, to change you, to correct you, to make you a better you, to use you to bring His love and His grace and His truth into the world. One day, when Jesus returns and brings all of history to a close, as Paul puts it in Ephesians 1 verse 10, the Father will bring together all things under Christ as the head. There will be no need for a constitution or for laws, because we will all be fully transformed in the likeness of Jesus, living the fruit of the Spirit in all of its fullness. But until that day, we will still need rules and regulations to point out bad and destructive behavior and hold people accountable for hurting others. We will still likely make mistakes, but we can also let the Spirit use our lives as examples of His blessing and grace, of His kindness and His compassion, so that others will also want to experience the power of God's Spirit that changes hearts and minds and heals marriages and families and friendships and even whole societies. I am so thankful that I can be part of this work that God is doing in the world, His kingdom, and may it come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Friends, we're going to spend a moment in prayer together, and I'm going to invite you to ask the Holy Spirit to fill you. Come, let's pray together. Almighty God, we consider Your word to us this morning, and although we understand the importance and the place of the laws of the land, and that because of the constitution we have, these laws are intended to bring blessing, Lord, we recognize that we still do and say things that hurt others. Lord, we still do and say things that do not show the evidence of Your Spirit at work in us. And for those things, we ask forgiveness. And Lord, we want to live lives in which we don't need the law, in which your Spirit moves us always to do the good, the right, the kind thing, the just thing, the blessed thing. Lord, that we will live lives that others will see you at work and will want to know you more. And the only way we can do that is if we have a relationship with you, if we spend time with you, and if your Holy Spirit takes control of our lives. Friends, I hope this doesn't make you feel awkward in any way, especially if you're sitting here with family in your home. But I want to invite you to ask the Holy Spirit to fill you once again. To ask Him to take control of your words and of your actions, of your plans, of your dreams and your decisions, of your choices, so that your life will show the fruit of His presence. Invite Him to be the Lord of your life. And Heavenly Father, as we pray this prayer for ourselves, we pray for our whole nation, for everyone living within this country, and indeed in the world. We know, Lord, that when more and more people come to faith in you, the laws become less and less necessary. We long and look forward to a day when your kingdom will come completely on earth as it is in heaven, that there will be no need for the laws that are written, because they will be written on our hearts, and we will be good and kind and compassionate to everyone, just as you are to us. This is our earnest prayer, in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, we are going to close worship today with that beautiful hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, and it's going to be sung in English, isiZulu, and Afrikaans. The blessing in the words of Romans 15. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. Amen. And God bless you, and you will see me next week again.